Tēnā koutou katoa, ko Cheryl Pym toka o ingoa, hei kai mahi aho ki te ahu ahu, te mataranga o te whariwananga o tākou, me te tapuai o rehua. Hi, I'm Cheryl Pym. I work within the Te Tapuai o Rehua Consortium, and I'm one of the National Coordinators for Technology Education. This is one of a series of webcasts and podcasts that we're developing as a PLD team, and this covers a range of conceptual understandings around technology education in the curriculum. This particular webcast is around attributes, design ideas, and conceptual designs. So what's the big deal? What we're going to cover in this webcast are things around attributes, design ideas, and conceptual designs. What are they, why they're important, how they support your students in their design development and in tech practice. We'll also cover a few things around teaching strategies to support their engagement and also to support student achievement. So what's the big deal about attributes? They are the really big brushstrokes, they're big descriptors of what the physical and functional nature of a technological outcome might be. So, for example, an attribute may refer to a potential outcome being small enough to be held in my hand or colourful enough to attract a child's attention. They are general characteristics of an outcome that may be suitable to meet the needs of the brief and to contribute to the fitness for purpose of an outcome. Specifications, on the other hand, are the actual requirements of the physical and functional nature of that outcome. So they're quite specific and very measurable. So in terms of a contrast to the above example, you would have the exact width, depth, length of an outcome, or you'd be stating the actual colour that it's going to be made in to meet my needs. I really consider them to be a big deal. They drive brief development and outcome development from level one of the curriculum, so they are the first port of call for students to develop their understanding around characteristics of outcomes. They expand student thinking. If we talk about a range of characteristics that might be useful in an outcome that's going to be fit for purpose, then we don't go straight to an end product. I think we're all finding that our students go, I'm going to make a, and they give you the detailed of that, so there's no design development work in the early periods. So really attributes begin that development of specifications, and it's really useful to note that specifications don't appear until level 5 in tech practice, which is around your year 9-10 development stages in your curriculum. So students up until then should actually be looking at attributes. They should be using attributes to evaluate their outcomes. So I really believe that this is an important part of practice. Attributes should be taught about really explicitly and used to develop design ideas and then to evaluate those design decisions and the fitness of purpose for outcomes, particularly in your junior programs, and impress the importance of exploring that nature of the outcome before kids get tied into the I'm going to make a and this is what it's going to look like. The point of exploration is to expand the ideas and push your students' thinking. This can't be done unless we have a really specific focus on teaching about attributes as well as using them. So just take a minute and reflect, where and how do you explicitly teach about attributes in your junior programs? So here's a wee teaching moment. Think about developing something for me or yourself where you're transporting work stuff. So what would be some desirable characteristics that would meet your needs? So for me, it's things like fits the iPad or my pencil case, the logbook, my walking shoes and lunch, and maybe sometimes even files or books or charts. It needs to be strong enough to be protective, but not too heavy for me to carry. It would be really great if it was insulated and kept my lunch cool in the summer, but easy to open and close so I can get my wallet out if I was going to put my wallet in there. Weatherproof, strong and durable, and it's colourful, particularly if I wanted to stand out from that sea of black bags in my meeting space. So you could see that it's quite descriptive, not specific, but really broad. Of course, being able to describe attributes as we get further down the track would rely on me having some language skills to be able to describe those characteristics of my transportation device. I find that introducing word banks early in a student learning program enables them to have access to that range of language that supports their ability to describe things. And that's a flow-on effect further down the track when students start looking at broader attributes. So here's an example of a word bank that I would perhaps use as a teaching tool. I would situate it in the classroom, use it as a chart on tabletops for kids. Building descriptors with my students empowers not only their language, but also develops their ability to think quite critically about the nature of outcomes across a range of contexts. You can go to taxido.com or wordle.com, and there are many other word cloud type creators on the web. Quite easy to use, and it would be really good if your kids built them rather than you having to do it. So further exploration around attributes leads to that wider possibilities. Your students in your classroom could undertake some attribute screening activities, give them actual outcomes, get them to rate the outcomes for possibility of inclusion, rate existing outcomes for design ideas that may suit the attributes previously described. So use it as a teaching tool, and so students get used to what they're actually talking about. So going back to the bag issue, or transporting my work stuff, if we use images or actual artifacts like these on the screen, students could discuss features about the bags and trolleys that would actually help them explore what may be suitable and what the attributes are. So if it was something about keeping my lunch cool, we may look at the centre picture where we've got some neoprene type cooler bags, how that might fit. Really, would only one of these fit the range of desirable attributes I've described? So then we can introduce this whole idea around snapshots of design ideas or little inspirations. So the word design ideas raises a bit of a discussion really about conceptual designs, concepts, grant concepts, concept sketching, design ideas. To me, a design idea begins with a little snapshot, a seed of an idea that's inspired by something. It could be the shape of this thing, it could be the line of that, the flow of something it reminds me of, it could be a thematic approach. So you could take the aspects of the bags previously shown and look for possible combinations of pieces of a whole that will inspire a unique outcome to fit my needs. So the introduction of exploring the social and physical environment in which I'm going to situate my outcome helps your curriculum language development. So students would then describe where the outcome would be used, who's going to interact with it, and then start screening further their attributes and design ideas. So the big deal about design ideas is that they're the initiators and inspiration. They're not entire entities to be copied, but aspects of a design that could be included. They need to be tested and evaluated against a range of filters. The context, the issue, the brief, the potential to contribute to fitness for purpose, the attributes that are described as the key characteristics, they're in line with stakeholder feedback. All of these factors act as your screening tools to assist your design decisions. So we go from a design idea, we make some decisions about that for inclusion or not against whatever filters we're using, and as the design process goes forward, we start getting closer and closer to a conceptual design that communicates something that will meet my needs or be fit for purpose. You may like to have a look at a quick video. There's a really neat video on YouTube that shows the development of a Lexus car. In that particular video, you see seeds of inspiration being developed. So there's a walk in the forest, there's a few other lines and conceptual designs arising from design ideas that have been gathered from a range of inspirations. It's quite a lovely video to watch. So take a break if you like and go and watch that and then come back. Put me on pause. Lots of people would like to do that very often. So curriculum language. Curriculum language, while difficult, is part of our learning process. We can't avoid it, and like any other curriculum and learning area, we have specific language that needs to be developed. So, from the glossaries that have been developed alongside the curriculum support material, we've got some very clear guidance around design ideas. So design ideas are those that have the potential to contribute to a conceptual design that meets the specifications of the brief. These are snapshots, not entireties. They're an inspirational line or colour or shape, texture or form, or even from a theme or a piece of work, an art piece or an existing outcome. They should be wide-ranging to give scope and breadth to the research and what might make a suitable design element for inclusion in the developing conceptual design. A conceptual design, however, is a complete description of how the solution would be implemented using presentation techniques such as scaled plans or drawings, models, computer simulations, written descriptions, annotated diagrams, lists of components and assembly instructions. And it really is a full description of the proposed technological outcome using media. So your students are then needing to develop their presentation skills in terms of sketching, annotated design ideas. It should convey all of the things that I would expect a fully functioning prototype to have, even though this is only showing something that has the potential to meet the brief and be fit for purpose. This is then developed further as the conceptual designers move forward into further testing and evaluation and moving into the prototyping phase. Just a wee reminder, of course, there are two types of modelling, functional modelling and prototyping, and both are used to test and evaluate design concepts at various stages of the development of an outcome, moving from my design ideas to the conceptual design to the prototype phase. Functional modelling, just to jog your memory, its intent is to test and communicate design ideas to evaluate suitability for use in a conceptual design. And while prototyping, on the other hand, is the modelling of a realised but yet to be implemented technological outcome. And in most cases, this is the one-off solution in our classrooms. And it's tested in situ, social and physical environment, and then evaluated in case there has to be any final modifications before manufacture. So by now, I've covered design ideas, conceptual designs, and I just hope you now have a clearer understanding of those and be clear about the use of language. Just want to, in drawing to a close, introduce you to a little process I developed to help teachers and students understand the different filters and screens often applied to a design process, moving from design ideas through to that conceptual design. And we filter against those range of things on the right hand side, the specs, the initial specs, of course, and then the refined specs, stakeholder feedback, some of the research we do. So as a student moves through, they go from a possible to a probable. This might be used, this is more likely to actually fit the bill. When you think the designer found their inspiration for this apartment building in the centre and lower right of the diagram, I found it quite intriguing because it reminds me of roller coasters, but also of bookshelves. And just to inspire those of you who, like me, you scribble but don't necessarily sketch quite clearly, the little sketch in the bottom left is by Frank Gehry, who always had that loose scribble inspirational sketch that began his design process. I'd encourage you to think about how your students gather inspiration, where they go, and how you actually teach them to be creative about that. So some final challenges. Where do you teach about attributes, design ideas, and conceptual design? How do you model these aspects and develop student understanding and their technological general literacy and their ability to use appropriate language? Where and how do you teach about how to find and develop their inspiration and design ideas? And have your students seen and unpacked conceptual designs to understand what they do? So I believe that if things like this aren't planned for, then it doesn't happen in your teaching. So I hope you find this useful. Go back and review things. Be inspired by one or two other comments I've made. And watch out for other webcasts coming to a place near you soon. Ka kite anō.